Hi, let's talk about the renal vasculature. In this video, we'll discuss the flow of blood to and through the kidneys. We'll also discuss left renal vein entrapment syndrome and discuss the relationships of the vessels that may contribute to this susceptibility. So the kidney is divided into several renal segments. Each segment is supplied by its very own segmental artery. So typically, what we see is the renal artery dividing into 5 segmental arteries. These segmental arteries are end arteries, which means that they do not anastomose with one another. Therefore, the segments that they supply with blood are standalone elements. They can be surgically removed or resected in a partial nephrectomy without jeopardizing the parenchyma of the other segments. Now, these segments include an apical, sometimes called the superior segment, as well as an inferior segment. There's also anterior superior segments and anterior inferior segments. And if you can imagine this segmental arteries segment, it will be a posterior segment that basically overlaps with the anterior superior and anterior inferior segments. So those are the 5 segments. Even though the segmental arteries and their branches don't anastomose, some of the intrarenal veins will typically anastomose with one another. Now let's take a look at how we might subdivide a segment. And I think that this is going to help reciprocally illuminate the names of some of the vasculature. So within a segment, we can have lobes. And a lobe is going to be a single renal pyramid plus all of the cortex immediately surrounding it. So about half of a column, all of the cortical arch, and all of the other columns that would surround it. So that's a lobe. Lobes can be further subdivided into lobules. And a lobule is a little bit of the cortical arch there between these cortical radiate arteries. And that's going to surround a single medullary ray. We won't get into the histology of that, but that is a lobule. And those arteries that define a lobule are cortical radiate arteries. And by various people, they may be referred to as interlobular arteries. Now let's take a look at the branching pattern here. So this begins with the renal artery. Renal artery divides into 5 segmental arteries. The segmental arteries are going to divide into interlobar arteries. So there's an interlobar artery. There's an interlobar artery. These interlobar arteries ride the margins between the medulla and the renal columns. And they round the bend of the pyramid, and on the base of the pyramid, they turn into arcuate arteries. So segmental to interlobar to arcuate arteries. Coming off, both the interlobar arteries and the arcuate arteries are the cortical radiate or interlobular arteries. So these cortical radiate arteries can pierce into the cortex either in the column or in the arch. They radiate out into the cortex. That's why they're called cortical radiate arteries. Fantastic name for them. These cortical radiate arteries are going to give rise to several afferent arterioles. The afferent arterioles feed into specialized capillary beds called glomeruli. This is where glomerular filtration occurs. A glomerulus is then going to feed into an efferent arterial. So afferent arterioles arrive at the glomerulus, efferent arterioles exit the glomerulus. And the efferent arterioles are going to supply paratubular capillaries as well as elaborations of paratubular capillaries called vasa recta, which translate into straight vessels. These are going to be associated with nephron loops of juxtamedullary nephrons. Paratubular capillaries feed into paratubular venules, which then feed into cortical radiate veins, which then feed into arcuate veins, into interlobar veins, and into renal veins. What I care about most is that you understand the branching pattern of the arteries through to the paratubular capillaries and vasa recta. So renal arteries into segmentals, into interlobars, into arcuate arteries, interlobar and arcuate arteries, both into cortical radiate arteries, then into afferent arterioles, then into glomeruli, then into efferent arterioles, then into paratubular capillaries and vasa recta. Now, if you're keeping score here from your knowledge of vasculature, you might see that we have a capillary bed, then feeding into another capillary bed by means of an intermediate vessel. Whenever we have that, it's called a portal system, and we call these the renal portal systems, and they are arterial portal systems because efferent arterioles connect these capillary beds. Now let's take a look at these cartoons of cortical and juxtamedullary nephrons and their blood supply. So here's the medulla, there's the cortex, here's an arcuate artery coming along and supplying blood up through a cortical radiate artery. Here are the afferent arterioles into the glomeruli, making that filtrate. Coming off of that is going to be the efferent arterioles. Efferent arterioles give rise to the paratubular capillaries. We need these paratubular capillaries so that we can have tubular secretion and reabsorption. On a juxtamedullary nephron, we also have these vasa recta, or these straight vessels, that dive down deep with that elongated nephron loop to pull water out of the medulla to maintain that hyperosmotic gradient that allows water to continually flow, chasing sodium out of that nephron loop. Now, on a grossly visible level, you're not going to see all of these things. If you have a microscope, fantastic. You'd be able to visualize everything. But in the lab, you're only going to be able to get to about the level of the arcuate artery. And even there, you really have to get lucky to find one that's sectioned right. So let's take a look at what we can see here. There's a renal artery. Here we can see a segmental artery. There is another segmental artery. Sometimes we may have accessory renal arteries. These aren't all that uncommon. About one in every three kidneys will have an accessory renal artery. They may either be hilar, meaning they enter the hilum of the kidney, or they may be polar, entering either the superior or inferior poles. These segmental arteries, they divide into interlobar arteries, as you recall. And if we follow this interlobar artery around the base, we can see it turning into an arcuate artery. Anything beyond the arcuate artery, you'd probably need latex-injected vasculature and or some sort of hand lens to see the cortical radiate arteries and a microscope to see beyond that. Now let's discuss some of the grossly visible veins here, because this is a fascinating story. So one very prominent vein of the abdomen here is the inferior vena cava, right? The inferior vena cava is going to receive blood from the lower limbs and pelvis. Some of the abdominal viscera directly, some of it indirectly after it's gone through the hepatic portal system on the other end of the liver. We'll also receive blood from the body wall. In terms of the kidneys drain directly into the caval system here via right and left renal veins. And what you can see is that the left renal vein is exceedingly longer than the right renal vein. And that left renal vein also has a very interesting relationship between the superior mesenteric artery and the abdominal aorta. So if I were to draw this, there is a very large abdominal aorta. There is the SMA coming down, and nestled between the two is the left renal vein. If there's any sort of aneurysm, either in the SMA or much more likely the abdominal aorta, that left renal vein can become entrapped. Now that's going to jeopardize the return of blood from the left kidney. It's also going to jeopardize the return of blood from several other sources, because on the left side, there are certain structures that drain into the left renal vein, whose veins typically on the right side drain directly into the inferior vena cava. These include the left gonadal vein, the left inferior phrenic vein, and the left suprarenal vein. You can see those two are sharing a common trunk there. So with left renal vein entrapment syndrome, also known as nutcracker syndrome, because this looks like a nutcracker, we're compromising blood flow from the left kidney, the left side of the inferior diaphragm, the left suprarenal gland, as well as the left gonad. Symptoms may include hematuria, which is blood in the urine, left flank and gonadal pain, and varicocele, which are varicosities of some of the testicular veins, like the pampiniform plexus becomes varicose. That can be very painful and uncomfortable. And that leads us to the assessment question for the video. Which vessels give rise to the afferent arterioles which supply the glomeruli? So let's think about this. Renal arteries give rise to segmental arteries, of which there are five. Segmental arteries, so renal to segmental. Segmental arteries give rise to interlobar arteries. Interlobar arteries are going to come around the corner of the pyramid into arcuate arteries. So those are interlobar, those are arcuate. Coming off of both arcuate and interlobar arteries are those cortical radiate arteries. The cortical radiate arteries, so cortical radiate, give rise to the afferents. So the afferent arterioles into the glomerulus, where we've got filtration occurring, into the efferent arterioles, which then give rise to the peritubular capillaries and vasa recta, so that we can have tubular secretion and reabsorption. So the correct answer is B. cortical radiate arteries supply the afferent arterioles to the glomeruli. Thank you very much for your time.